Please come to order. Good morning. Welcome to the Commissioners of St. Mary's County meeting this date, Tuesday, April 4th, 2017. I am Randy Guy, President of the Commissioners of St. Mary's County. I'd like to introduce the other Commissioners. Commissioner Jarby, who represents First Commissioner District, which includes Ridge, Piney Point, St. Croix Island, is unable to attend today. He's out on work. Next to him, representing the Second Commissioner District, which includes Leonardtown, Hollywood, Mr. Mike Hewitt.
Good morning.
Sitting to my left, representing the Third Commissioner District, which includes Charlotte Hall, 7th District, Golden Beach, and Mechanicsville, Mr. John O'Connor.
Good afternoon.
Representing the Fourth Commissioner District, which includes Lexington Park, Summit, California, and Great Mills, Mr. Todd Morgan. Seated at the end is Dr. Rebecca Bridger, who is our County Administrator. On my immediate right is Sharon Ferris. She's our recorder. And behind the glass, which very few of us see, is Ms. Amy Carter. Our video media producer is behind the glass. So please look good coming up to the front here because you're on TV. Please turn your cell phones off or on vibrate. When you come to the presenter's table, please approach by coming down the center aisle. And remember, this meeting is being televised, so you need to clearly speak and directly into the microphone for recording purposes. We'll be holding a public hearing tonight at 6:30 p.m. in this meeting room on the proposal to amend Chapter 223 of the Code of St. Mary's County, Maryland to repeal and reenact provisions for a development impact fee. Please stand at this time. The invocation will be done by Commissioner Morgan.
We're an Almighty who have made the heaven and the earth for your glory, to serve thee in freedom and peace. Grant to the people of our country, our state, and our county a zeal for justice and the strength of forbearance, that we may use our liberty in accordance with thy will. Through Jesus Christ, the Lord's name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
The Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Commissioner Morgan. Next, I need the approval of the consent agenda.
I move to approve the consent agenda as presented.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Ayes have it. Next, we have a proclamation for equal pay for our ladies and women in the county and the state in the United States of America. So I think Norma Pipkin and various staff members, please come forward.
Don't get me started.
I'm covered with standby, Commissioner Hughes. Oh, we're all by ourselves.
Feel tall. The proclamation reads as follows. Whereas 54 years after the passage of the Equal Pay Act of 1963, women and people of all color continue to suffer the consequences of inequality pay differentials. And whereas the Civil Rights Act of 1964 further strengthened the laws for gender equality, and whereas according to the statistics released by the U.S. Census Bureau, year-round full-time working women in 2014 earned only 79% of the earnings of full year-round full-time working men, and whereas over a working lifetime this wage disparity impacts Social Security benefits and pensions, and whereas fair pay strengthens the security of families today and cases future retirement costs, while enhancing the American economy in a fair pay equity can be implemented simply and without undue cost or hardship to both the public and private sectors. And whereas Equal Pay Day was originated by the National Committee on Pay Equality in 1996 as a public awareness event to illustrate the gap between men's and women's wages. Now therefore, we the Commissioners of St. Mary's County do proclaim Tuesday, April 4th, 2017, Equal Pay Day in St. Mary's County and urge the citizens of the community to recognize the full value of women's skills and their significant contributions to the labor force. Today, April 4th, 2017. Who is the spokesperson? Woman?
I guess I am.
Okay.
First of all, I'd like to thank the commissioners for recognizing this day. I think it's important. This is not just an issue in St. Mary's County. It's not just in Maryland. It's nationwide. And we need to bring awareness of the fact that women are behind. And you'll notice that a whole lot of us are wearing red. And that's because women are in the red. And we're just sort of demonstrating that. Are you seeing red, Commissioner?
We're wearing some red, I'll say.
But we really, it's not just a woman's issue either. It's a family. It affects everybody and the economy. It's just really important that people be aware of this, and we educate women, and we have to encourage young women to go into higher paying career fields, STEM fields. But even today, if a woman has equal education as a man, maybe comparable work experience, she still earns less than a man in the same field. And it's not right. And we want to change it.
Thank you.
So, thank you.
And the other ladies like to speak.
I was just going to mention, my husband Larry is with me. He's very brave, but it's not an issue just for women. It's men, too, the men that we work with, the men that are in our lives that know this has been going on and need to help us, need to speak up for us. And I appreciate it. And I wish any of you other men out there who would want to join us would come up, because it's important.
And I think we all have granddaughters that are going to be affected by this.
And we do have people from Together We Will who are also standing with us.
And we're so glad to have community involvement in this issue.
And these are two of our commission members who are here in spirit. They have to work because they have to earn money.
At a lower pay.
And so they have other commitments too. So thank you.
Thank you, ladies.
Well, thank you all very much.
Thank you.
You want to come up and join the photo? Our PIO is the perfect person, too.
Call to the back.
I'm always in the back. I don't worry about it. Second proclamation we have is for the 2017 National County Government Month. Brilliant ideas at work.
Okay.
So who's coming from the county? Dr. Bridget?
And the department heads.
And the department heads were here? Come on up, guys.
Yeah. All department heads, come up, please.
You get a photo anyway.
Brilliance at work.
Here we go.
And who was all the proclamations?
You guys on the inside.
Feel better? We're here for a proclamation to honor all the county employees. And as we said last week, I don't know how we could do our jobs without you and your staffs and everything you've done for us. So, whereas the nation's 3,069 counties serving more than 300 million Americans provide essential services to create healthy, safe, and vibrant communities by moving America forward by providing health care, administering justice, keeping communities safe, creating economic opportunities, and much more. In words of St. Mary's County, all counties take pride in the responsibility to protect and enhance the health, welfare, and safety of its residents in efficient and cost-effective ways. And whereas through the National Association of Counties President Brian Desalog Brilliant Ideas at Work Initiative, NACO is encouraging counties to focus on those innovative programs and services that strengthen communities. And whereas in order to remain healthy, vibrant, and safe, America's counties provide public health, just safety, infrastructure, transportation, technology, environmental stewardship, and economic services that play a key role in everything from the residents' daily commutes and emergency response. And whereas every year since 1991, the National Association of Counties has encouraged counties across the country to actively promote their own programs and services to the public. Now, therefore, we, the commissioners of St. Mary's County, who proclaim April 2017 National County Government Month and encourage county officials, employees, and citizens to learn more about the valuable services provided by the county government. Today, April 4th, 2017. so you'll be the lead spokesperson?
Thank you, Commissioners, for recognizing NACO's National County Government Month, and thank you to all the leadership here, for the directors and the hard work that they do every day, and to all of our county employees that make it happen.
Great. Thank you. Now you have one big good community photo. How's that?
Everybody in front has a good community photo here, man. We want to document this sometime.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you all very much. Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Hey, stay up there, guys. Stay up there.
We have one more to go.
Okay, next we have a presentation from the Office of the Governor, citation recognizing County Government Month. Gretchen Hardman, please. Good to see you're still here with us.
Yes. We're going to hang out all day.
There you go. Thank you. Thank you. Enjoy yourself down here.
Yeah.
Enjoy it.
Well, thank you. Thank you for you all and the county commissioners and the county governments, your department heads, for all you do for our community. I'm honored to be here to recognize National County Government Month on behalf of Governor Hogan and the state of Maryland. And I'd like to read this and present the citation to you. Governor of the state of Maryland, to commissioners of St. Mary's County, honor county government, greetings. Be it known that on behalf of the citizens of this state, in recognition of a well-deserved tribute to honor and celebrate the outstanding programs, excellent work, and services that strengthen communities in our nation's counties, helping to protect and enhance the health, welfare, and safety of our residents in efficient and cost-effective ways, and as the people of Maryland join in promoting April as National County Government Month, and encouraging all county officials, employees, and citizens to learn more about the valuable services provided by their county government, we are pleased to confer upon this governor's citation, under my hand and the great seal of the state of Maryland, this fourth day of April, 2017. Signed by Lawrence J. Hogan, Jr., Governor, Lieutenant Governor Boyd K. Rutherford, and Secretary of State John C. Wobensmith.
Thank you very much. Thank you for being here. On behalf of the county, I'd like to thank the five good group of men to work with. No women yet. But anyway, they've done a great job, and I'm proud of all of them. I'm proud of all of our directors out there and the various staff work that we've done. And of course, all the people in St. Mary's County that make this happen, the 800 plus employees that we have. And I thank everybody. I thank all the volunteers that participate and all of our boards and everything. It's all definitely a community effort to make things happen in St. Mary's County. And look forward to continue working with that. And I've enjoyed it myself. So thank you very much. Thank you.
Thanks.
We're going to have a photo op right up here.
Oh.
Right here.
Okay.
Thank you very much. The next part of the program, we go right into the county administrator time.
Thank you, Commissioner President Guy. And Commissioners, I draw your attention to the draft meeting agenda for Tuesday, April 18th. And a reminder, there is no meeting scheduled next week on April 11th. So
So for on April 18th, you begin in the morning with one proclamation for National Animal Control Officers Week and a presentation for recognition of Brandon Cullens. Then you have the presentation from the St. Mary's Metropolitan Commission for the FY18 Capital Improvement Budget and the FY19 through 23 Capital Improvement Plan. The Department of Emergency Services and Technology will bring forth a decision on extending the existing MetroCast agreement, and then tentatively scheduled from the Department of Emergency Services and Technology is the Hazard Mitigation Plan introduction. That evening, 6:30 p.m., you hold a public hearing from the Department of Finance on the ordinance to grant a property tax credit to certain elderly individuals and veterans, and the FY18 recommended budget, which will be held at Leonard Town High School Auditorium. So for this morning's business meeting, item B, is Mr. Erickson here. St. Mary's County Metropolitan Commission to introduce the easement and right-of-way agreement with Great Mills Canoe and Kayak Launch. George Erickson, Executive Director, presenting. Good morning, Mr. Erickson.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
We've missed you, buddy.
Title than it is. How are you doing today?
Good.
It's good to be back.
How are you doing today?
What you have before you today in item B is a simple deed and easement agreement. It's associated with the development of a project that's been being worked on since 2011. There was a feasibility study done back in 2011. To upgrade the existing station, Great Mills Pump Station, that was built in the 80s. Unfortunately, it was initially built, it was in the St. Mary's River floodway. It floods a lot of time during its operations. It's extremely close to the bridge down at Great Mills Road and Route 5 intersection, so when the state highway does their bridge widening, you know, it's gonna be a project that's gonna be in the way, whether it be a full taking or a partial taking. The pump station also needs to be upgraded, not only in terms of its age, but in terms of its capacity. So it'll be increased from 656 EDUs, I think, up to about 1,500 EDU capacity. It'll pump about 1,000 gallons a minute. And actually, the wastewater treatment that's collected there gets pumped all the way down to the interceptor line. It's in FDR Boulevard Phase 2B, which is way down by Shangri-La Drive, and eventually it all goes to Marley Taylor. Our project is fairly expensive. It's a $7 million project. What people don't realize is these particular facilities have a lot of infrastructure underground. The wet pump room and the dry pump room are 25 feet wide, 22 feet long, and 25 feet tall. So if you can imagine in this room the size, what that size is. Doesn't look like a whole heck of a lot above the ground, but it's a lot of material underneath the ground. It's a solid poured piece of concrete. We have our SHA permit. And we got that on December 20th, 2016. We also have approval from the state to go forward with a loan on this particular project. The good news about these MDE loans is that they are only borrowed. It's similar to the airport. You know how now the airport, we have to bid the project before we even do an application. The state loans for these types of projects, the water quality projects, are no different. We have to bid the project before we get a loan. So we bid the project, we get the bid results. Our MetCom board passes a resolution to authorize us to borrow. Then we actually come to the county commissioners to get your concurrence with backing us in your full faith and credit and authorizing us to borrow. This project was prior approved. It is included in our debt capacity analysis, which you'll see on the 18th of April. We'll be bringing that to you. We've readjusted the CIB extensively, and I know that's not part of this discussion. I've taken about $10 million of projects that were approved in the FY17 budget for 18, and we've moved them out and distributed them. So our debt to assessed value, or assessed value, is under 1% between FY17 and 2023. So we've done a lot with moving projects around in the CIB, and actually, I think, stabilizing and controlling, at least for the foreseeable future, where we were headed initially, I think. So I hope to present that to you on the 18th of April. This isn't about that. But in granting this easement that goes through your canoe and kayak launch, which we would obviously hope that you would approve, there is more action to take on this project by this board. So this would be the first step, not the last step. But you are the last line of approvals that prevents us, I would say, from bidding the project in the next month. We like to have all our easements in place before we bid. That's typically what the county does as well.
Good idea.
So my only question at the end of the day, when we do all this, and if we ever get the funding from the state to proceed with the widening of 5 from Great Mills Road, up to Flatiron Road, even up the hill. This will be all out of the way, and we will have no issues with MECOM lines or anything like that. Is that true?
It should be true. The lines are deep enough. We're doing two 1,260-foot lines or 1,260-foot lines adjacent to Route 5. I'm not going to say that those lines wouldn't be impacted, but those impacts would be a direct bore. They would be borne by SHA because we have prior rights, at least for those lines. They've approved our relocation of these two lines, so we're hoping that they've approved them far enough out of the way that it won't be a conflict for them. But yes, sir, the idea is for all the facilities to be relocated before they do any work at that location.
Well, that's just my biggest concern is making sure that we have done this and moved everything properly prior to, if we ever get the opportunity to wind that road, which you know from sitting in your previous chair is a huge transportation concern for everybody.
Yes, sir.
And I just don't want to have come back or future boards have to hear, we missed it by 3 feet.
That's the collective goal. Yes, okay. Sir.
Thank you.
This has already been coordinated then with SHA, really?
Yes, sir. We got the permit on December 20th of last year.
Okay. Do you see any impacts to people traveling through that area while construction goes on?
Probably minor impacts with the flagging.
So you don't have an issue with people at 4 o'clock are having a heck of a time getting through there and they won't have a lane blocked and things like that?
I can't say that now, but traffic control is a high priority in the bid documents.
Good. That's a good way of putting it.
I like that.
It's not going to be the standard traffic control plan. It's going to have a little bit more emphasis. Yes, sir.
Okay, because as you know, people are frustrated getting through.
It's nice having sat over here and going over there to be able to include some of those concerns. Yes, sir.
Good.
Any other questions?
I appreciate your leadership. It's a breath of fresh air to know somebody that's over there that's running it and working with everybody. So thank you. And I move to authorize the commission president to execute a deed of easement and agreement and related documents between the commissioners of St. Mary's County and the St. Mary's County Metropolitan Commission for the purpose of a permanent easement for sewer lines to be constructed for the Metropolitan Commission's new Great Mills wastewater pumping station.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Ayes have it.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, George.
You're welcome.
Thank you, Commissioners. And item C is from the Department of Public Works and Transportation to introduce Thompson Subdivision Road Acceptance and Signposting. John Groger, Interim Director, presenting. Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning, Commissioners.
Again.
This item is to accept Jillian Grace Court into the County Highway Maintenance System. Thompson Subdivision is off of Willows Road in Lexington Park. It's in addition to the Pembroke Subdivision, done by the same developer. And the final inspection was completed on January 3rd, 2017, with punch list items complete and roadway found to be acceptable on January 30th, 2017. The road is 339 feet long. The original road construction plans were approved and a public works agreement issued on November 13th, 2012, with a $93,000 surety. A maintenance and repair bond in the amount of $9,400 has been posted for a period of 1 year to protect the infrastructure, roads and storm drains, etc., from latent defects and guaranteed repairs. So the development is an 11-lot addition to the Pembroke subdivision, and 0.6 miles in length. So we're requesting the CSMC adopt the resolution to accept Thompson Court, Jillian Grace Court, into the St. Mary's County Highway Maintenance System. Also requesting that they adopt an ordinance setting the maximum speed of 25 miles an hour and establishing a stop controlled intersection at the Colby Drive intersection. And all homes have been completed.
I've had a question about maximum speeds or minimum speeds. Do we have a minimum speed? Some people reached out to me and said, Mike, we got kids in here and people go too fast. What's minimum speed? 10 mile an hour, 15 mile an hour?
The board can establish any speed limit they want. The general consensus is that speeds under 25 miles an hour are not enforceable by the Sheriff's Department.
Okay, so 25 is usually the minimum?
25 is usually the minimum.
Okay, thanks.
Mr. President, that I move to adopt the resolution to accept Jillian Grace Court in the Thompson subdivision to the St. Mary's County Highway Maintenance System and to adopt the ordinance setting a maximum speed and establishing a stop sign at the intersection of Julian Grace Court in the Thompson subdivision.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Ayes have it.
Thank you.
Item D, Commissioners, was from the Department of Emergency Services and Technology to introduce the Memorandum of Understanding between St. Mary's County Emergency Services and Technology and the Department of the Navy. Bob Kelly, CIO, presenting. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Before you this morning, Commissioners, seeking authorization for the Commissioner President to execute the Memorandum of Understanding between Emergency Services and Technology and Department of Navy. This is actually the second time I've brought this before the Board of County Commissioners. The first time was, it was originally approved in August 6th of 2013, so it was the prior board. Unfortunately, although we executed and we signed our portion of the agreement, the Navy had some challenges getting the signatures, and since that time, the names have changed. So we have an updated Memorandum of Understanding. The contents of the MOU remain the same. Really, the only thing that has changed are the signatories on the Navy side. So we're seeking authorization. And basically, this Memorandum of Understanding is a result of the consolidation on the Navy side of their 911 dispatching in Naval District Washington area. So when they move their dispatchers from Pax River up to Washington, the Washington Navy Yard, they sought a memorandum of understanding so that we defined exactly how 911 calls that we may receive at our 911 center originating from the base would be transferred to their dispatch center. And we do that via what we call a warm transfer. So if someone calls from the base and hits our 911 center, we have a one-button dial for the Navy Dispatch Center, and as soon as their dispatcher is on the line and we've confirmed that there's communications between the caller and their dispatch center, then we drop off.
I do remember this well.
It was a good presentation.
And a couple, and there were a couple other issues along the way with that also relative to, you know, the fire departments and things like that. So, mm-hmm. You know, I can sit there and say I honestly thought that after we went through this and we went through the Navy and we had it all signed, it was done. So thanks for keeping on top of it. I just, you know, don't know how I guess it's part of the problem when you decentralize the Navy. Like you said, emergency call comes, it goes to D.C., then it comes back down the road again, and you can press technology buttons all you want, but you know, 65 miles away is 65 miles away.
Right, exactly. Yeah. Mr. Kelly, tell me, I just had a couple quick questions. Mm-hmm. So I've always been under the impression that the Navy has their own police force and fire department and this, that, or the other.
They do, yes.
So if a call originates on the Navy base, I would assume that the Navy base are the first responders.
Generally, that is the case. However, with the cell phone technology and at certain portions, certain parts of the base, you know, quite frankly, a cell phone calling on certain portions of the base may actually get the 911 center over in Calvert County.
Okay.
Because it's hitting a tower over there. And it's possible down in our in San Inigo that it actually goes across the Potomac.
Virginia.
To Virginia. Well,
and I guess that leads to my second question. And, as someone who can't get on the base unless I have a, you know, invitation from the captain or something. So these ambulances coming onto the base, I can't imagine the security is going to say, hold up, stop, let me see your picture ID. I mean, if you get somebody who's in a 911 situation, you want them there pretty quick. So is that kind of rushed?
Well, we
through?
Do have mutual aid agreements with the base, and so I would just say that first of all, we have agreements that are established that allow them to request services from our volunteers and from our police and Maryland State Police also, both fire and EMS in addition. And there's protocols that we have when that request comes in or when they just need us. And those protocols include getting access to the base. So the quick answer to your question is we notify them, they know they're coming, and we have the protocols that make sure they get through. Yes.
Any other questions, Commissioner?
Mr. President, I move to approve and authorize yourself to execute the Memorandum of Understanding between the St. Mary's County Emergency Services and Technology and the Department of the Navy, Navy District, Washington, for the rerouting of Navy 911 calls originating from the naval installations in St. Mary's County.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Ayes have it.
Thank you, Commissioner.
Thank you, Bob.
Item E, Commissioners, is from the Department of Recreation and Parks to present the DHMH grant proposal, Memorandum of Understanding and Related Certifications and Assurances. Brian Lowy, Director, and Christy Bishop, Therapeutic Recreation Specialist, presenting. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon,
Ms. Lowy.
We are here today to present the FY 2018 Maryland Department of Health and Mental Hygiene Human Services Contract Proposal, Memorandum of Understanding and Related Certifications and Assurances on behalf of the Department of Recreation and Parks in the amount of $29,781 for the New Horizons Summer Camp. Recreation and Parks is requesting renewal of these funds from the Department of Health and Mental Hygiene Developmental Disabilities Administration in the amount of $29,781. The total financial impact is $64,872, $29,781 in state funding, and $35,091 in FY18 county departmental program funds. Recreation Parks has operated this summer camp for children with special needs for over 26 years. The New Horizons Summer Camp offers a summer full of activities, trips, and events for children with disabilities, anywhere from ages 4 through 20. These grant funds have been received for over 17 years since the program has been in place. And with me today is Christy Bishop, our therapeutic recreation specialist, if you should have any questions concerning the camp.
I just want to compliment. You've done a great job over all these years. It's just amazing how you've been able to reach out and touch and help all these kids, and you deserve a big kudo for that.
Thank you. Love it.
Mr. Lowy, I want to tell you, I wholeheartedly support this. I want to give your group a big shout out for an event I attended this past week in the Easter egg hunt over at the fairgrounds. I have four granddaughters, and thank God I had all four of them there, and it was a mess, but it was fun. And what I want to tell you is I was surprised at all the number of children, how they efficiently it was run, how there was an egg for everybody. Nobody lost, everybody won. And to all your staff, hats off for a great job. Now, as I'm a commissioner, but I'm also a citizen, I'm a granddad, I'm a father, I'm a husband. And what made that trip very special is I helped my granddaughter into the car. She's 4 years old, Maddie Rose. And she said, "Papa, that was fun. And we need to do it again."
Good
job.
Glad to hear.
Thank you.
Did you make sure Commissioner Hill got the golden egg?
No, no. Hey, look. Maddie Rose found a golden
egg. Did she find a golden
egg? Yeah.
She
was lucky.
That's one of our very special days that we put on as a department. And I have to say thank you to staff. Thank you to commissioners that attended over the years. It's special, and it helps support our scholarship program.
Very good.
So it's a very special day that keeps on giving throughout the year.
I've heard a lot of good things about it.
Absolutely.
Good job.
Excellent.
Yes. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Anything else, Commissioner?
Well, I move to approve the Maryland Department of Health and Mental Hygiene Human Services Contract Proposal, Memorandum of Understanding and Related Certifications and Assurances on behalf of the Department of Recreation and Parks in the amount of $29,781 for the New Horizons Summer Camp, and authorize the Commissioner President to execute the related documents.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Ayes have it. Thank you all very much.
Thank you, Commissioners. Have a good day.
And item F, Commissioners, is from the Department of Aging and Human Services to introduce the FY18 Senior Rides Program Grant Application. Lori Jennings Harris, Director, and Julie Birch, Senior Rides Coordinator, presenting. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Thank you,
ladies.
Dr. Bridget. Good afternoon, Commissioners. Can't see over the screen. So Julie Birch is joining me today. Julie is our Senior Rides Coordinator, and I just wanted you to have an opportunity to see and meet her. She is a person who coordinates all the trips for the seniors who need transportation and have no other transportation options. So this is the FY18 Senior Rides Grant Application with the Maryland Transit Administration. And if we are successful, we will receive funds for the 10th year for this program. We are requesting $25,977 in state funds. The local match required by the county is $8,659. And the transportation that we provide is provided by volunteer drivers using their own vehicles. to seniors who need assistance getting to the grocery store, to run errands, as well as to medical appointments.
I only have one question. When someone uses their personal car to transport somebody for us, do they have any liability if, God forbid, they're in an accident or something like that?
We have insurance. We have a secondary insurance policy.
So it does transfer over to whoever's doing it for us?
Mm-hmm.
Good.
Are you getting enough volunteers to make this happen?
At this time, we have 23 volunteers.
Do you have enough right now to?
Maybe one or two a month possibly aren't
wow.
filled, but mostly.
So you got 23 and you need one or two a month. That's tremendous. Okay. And these people are allowed to use, do you pay them to transport or do they?
They get mileage reimbursement.
Mileage reimbursement, okay. Very good. Any other questions, Commissioners?
I move to approve the Senior Rides Program Grant Application Project MD-1805 from the Maryland Department of Transportation on behalf of the St. Mary's County Department of Aging and Human Services in the amount of $36,636 and authorize the Commissioner President to execute the related documents.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Ayes have it.
Thank you, ladies, very much.
Item G is from the Department of Finance to introduce the budget amendment to realign county departments, elected officials, FY17 budget for personal services accounts. Jeanette Cudmore, CFO, presenting. Good afternoon.
Oh, it is afternoon, isn't it?
It is afternoon, Jeanette.
Well, Commissioners, this is the third time this year that we're bringing funds back to your emergency reserve. We're putting $412,635 to your reserve, which will bring your balance up to $1.9 million. This comes from salary savings. We've had a lot of turnover this year, changing in health insurance with the new hires. So we've looked at all the departments, elected officials. Now, we do not restore funds or take care of the shortfalls or whatnot from the sheriff's office. They did come forward, I think, in March to take care of some internal realignments.
What do we think our usual amount should be in the commissioner's reserve? $500,000?
Normally it's $500,000. In 17, we started off with $670,000.
Okay. So the fact that we're at 1.9, it seemed like it would be prudent to shift some of that money to our reserves or unassigned reserves or.
If you don't have anything really to use it for, you could let it drop to fund balance. And then that'll offset any revenue shortfalls. That we may have at the end of the year.
I know it's another subject, but Finn too.
The Finn's got some money, and that might be something we might want to look at maybe in May or June to realign, because I think there's some PAYGO funding that we should realign so we don't lose it, and maybe reduce bond funding.
Okay.
But we'll bring all that to you May and June timeframe.
By May 1st.
In closing, yes.
Well, I move to approve the budget amendment in the amount of $503,860. Realigning $91,225 in county departments and elected officials' personal services accounts and transferring $412,635 to the commissioner's emergency reserve due to salary savings and authorize the commissioner president to execute the related documents.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Ayes have it.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Jeanette.
Thank you, Commissioners, and this concludes County Administrator time.
Okay, let's go right into Commissioner time. We'll start with, let's go with Commissioner Morgan this day.
Thank you, Mr. President. I went away on a vacation a couple weeks ago and didn't have any email, phone, and it was wonderful. So I came home at 3 o'clock last Tuesday morning and really didn't do a lot of time catching up on my readings. But there will be a public hearing tonight on the impact fee. And I can say that over the last week, there's been enough information, disinformation, misinformation put out about this impact fee to keep anybody's head who's paying attention spinning. I can say that there needs to be some adjustments, probably the impact fee, but there are a huge pile of legal entanglements. Again, information, disinformation, misinformation. And I can say in the present form of the ordinance, I will not be able to support any way whatsoever increasing an impact fee from $4,500 to whatever the number was that was published in the paper. So I would encourage everyone tonight to come out and speak up on this issue to hear what you got to say, because as I said, oftentimes the details are daunting in this impact fee, and it's easy to point fingers and say, somebody else should pay and I shouldn't have to pay, or this has happened and now it's somebody else's fault. But we are a growing community, and there are needs and services we have to be able to provide to our residents. And some people may agree they don't want those services, and some people may agree we need more of those services. So impact fee is just is one avenue out there. But as I said, in the present form of the ordinance, this commissioner is not going to support it at all. And I look forward to seeing a very full room here this evening to have this discussion. So thank you.
Well, first, I'd like to thank the Department of Public Works and Transportation for taking care of the stop signs on Dr. Johnson Road. So I travel the road daily, and I can tell you just from the basic observing of traffic, they're slowing down, and they're using the stop signs. People were complaining that the stop signs were going there, but I can tell you one thing, there's school bus stops in those areas, and the fact that I'm not watching vehicles apex a turn by across from the farm is a big difference from what I've seen in the future. And if you don't know what apexing means, it means treating a curve as if it's straight, going right through it because you're going so fast. So thank you for getting that up and working with the public. I did have the chance, and it's funny that it's county government. We're recognizing county government and all the contributions that go on. And if you haven't had a chance to fully appreciate county government and how we act in an orderly fashion, and if you think sometimes things are dysfunctional, it's really relative. So I had a chance to sit, and I usually sit in a lot of council meetings throughout the state for various different reasons. But last night I had the privilege of sitting in one that you would have thought Ringling Brothers and Barlow Bailey Circus was in town. And it was absolutely painful to sit there. There just the lack of organization, even the agenda was being manipulated as they went through, executive sessions being thrown in, and people making motions. It was just chaos and anarchy. And, you know, then they had their attorney sitting there who, for the life of me, I thought he was the town administrator, the way he was acting. So when it comes relative and the professionalism of staff at our county level and what they do, I have to say thank you, because making this run and the staff and all the employees, it's not easy. It's difficult. And then on top of that, you're dealing with five strong personalities who have five different opinions and five different ways of handling things. So, and that's for our department heads. So I thank our department heads for growing thick skin and dealing with things as they get thrown at you left and right, because sometimes it's just not that easy. And then we come here and everything's professional. And that's how things should be. So I thank you for that. And then last on the impact fee, I'm glad we are where we are right now. The conversation would not be happening unless somebody poked the bear. And I said this when I ran for office. I have no problem doing the right thing and then standing on the line saying I did the right thing. And the right thing is adjusting this fee for the county. Now, how it gets adjusted and where it gets adjusted, that's the methodology that between our department heads and this board we have to figure out. But we wouldn't be having this conversation unless somebody took that step forward and said, we need to do something. And I appreciate the news for doing their math and putting their calculations out there. We can't control what they write, and nothing is solidified. You know, I will say that all the correspondence that I have gotten, one of the biggest things that I can notice, and it's very, very defined, is the people that oppose it are the special interest groups, the Southern Maryland Association of Realtors, a lot of developers. The people that are for it are the other 117,000 people in the county. And that's kind of how I look at it. And most of the people that are against it don't even live in the county. So, and I think that comes down to misinformation and people making assumptions and not having the full information from surrounding jurisdictions. So it's, tonight will be interesting, and I encourage everybody to come out, especially the special interest groups, and I think for me, because it'll just prove my point in general when they come out and oppose the impact fee. Because to me, those are the people that are making money on the back of the people buying new homes. So there's a lot that can go into this, and I think there's a method to get there, but I think the step needed to be taken to move forward and have the conversation for the people of this county and the growth that's coming here. And then second, I can't believe we're actually on time today.
Y'all doing a good job.
That's it.
Mike?
I'll tell you one thing. On the radio this morning and in the paper, they said my wife was a lieutenant. I love the promotion. It's great if it was actually real. I'd want the back pay, but she's a corporal. in a patrol capacity with 16 years, not a lieutenant. But, it's in the heart of the sheriff. I mean, you know. That's it. But I just wanted to correct that one thing because it was funny. But anyway, thank you.
Mike?
Yes. First thing I'd like to mention is we had a meeting this morning with the joint NAS County. And what was important is several important topics were discussed, but they're going to be bringing a couple hundred jobs with the new helicopter they're bringing to PAX. But what I thought was very important, that the EUL, Enhanced Use Lease Program, that they were battling with out there at the Navy for probably the last 4 or 5 years, has been canceled. And the captain said that this morning, and I'm glad that it is. It's been a big concern to a lot of businesses outside the gate, and I think it's better for St. Mary's County that it is. Now again, to go on to what others have already said, tonight's a public hearing. And it's an important one. It's about impact fees. Now, the last time we talked about impact fees was a couple weeks ago. And what we talked about is raising them 5%. I oppose that because I don't know if 5% is the right number. I've constantly talked about taking steps in the right direction. And different people have said this is a step in the right direction. But I believe that if you have a mile to go, you shouldn't take 1 foot. Maybe it takes 1 foot to go a mile, but you need to identify where you need to be. And that goes to what I call the formula that we use to determine an impact of a new dwelling in this area. Recently we heard it was $26,000 and some change. And last year we heard it was $23,000 and some change. A couple weeks ago, again, when we brought it all up, I asked staff to show me the formula. I mean, I've seen the formula. It's complicated. But I'm a numbers guy, and I took it upon myself to research this formula. I think the formula is flawed. I'm not saying the people are flawed who are doing it. I just think the process is flawed. They talk about high schools that can cost up to $6,500 impact on a new home. Those high schools, we haven't built one in 25 years or so when we built Leonardtown, and there's no plans to build one for the next 10 years. They talked about middle schools, which is a $3,100 impact. They're not projected to have a middle school till probably 7 or 8 years out. They talked about buying land for these schools. Well, we bought Hayden Farm, 10 years ago? We already own the land, and they continue to use that as an impact. So, and there's also the imposition of federal and state monies involved. So while I don't criticize the formula, I'm just saying I'm not sure it's accurate. I don't believe it's a true reflection of what the impact is. But I'm a reasonable, practical person. That's how I ran my business. And I believe that a reasonable person should be able to understand these impacts and should be able to follow them if someone wants to lay them out in a formula. Granted, not everybody has the same aptitude to learn, but those people who want to should be able to follow this. Now, we've talked about impact fees for the town of Leonardtown and how they're $21,000, but they include water and sewer hookups. Our impact fees don't do that. We talked about Charles County and their impact fee of $16,000 or whatever it may be and some change, and a half a point on their transfer tax. But what's important is The Water and Sewer Department in Charles County is part of county government. Those people, that county government, those commissioners, can set those hookup rates. We can't in St. Mary's County. We have a Metropolitan Commission. We talk about Calvert County. Calvert County also has their water and sewer folded into the government. Now, their water and sewer is an enterprise fund. Those people who use it pay for it. That is a model I think we should copy, or at least take a look at. But all these things I'm bringing out is we're talking apples and oranges when we say, hey, look what they're doing up the road, or look what they're doing across the bridge, or look what they're doing in the town of Leonardtown. We need to take a hard look at this. Like I say, the last time we talked about this, we were going from $4,500 to $4,725. The next time we saw something about it was in the newspaper. And there was a new formula. We backed into the $26,000. And that's going to impact from $4,500 to $12,744 July 1st, 3 short months. And then a year later, go up another $12,744. It'll be an increase from $4,500 to $25,488. We have to be careful. We have to be thoughtful about how we implement this. I've personally ran against higher taxes and more fees. But I'm practical. If this impact fee is in fact causing other people to pay, and that's something else I have an issue with. If we've been so far below in these impact fees for so long, since 2000, why haven't our income taxes or our property taxes have gone up? They haven't. So what I'm saying here, we need to take our time. We need to slow down. I cannot support this ordinance the way it's written. It talks to how we have to have this impact fee for water, sewer, sanitation, and we don't. We need to clean it up. We need to make it clear to a reasonable person why we think of what it is. And if that results in an increase in the impact fee, I will vote for it. But I will also say if we have additional revenues from impact fees, maybe we can have a lower property taxes. Maybe there's a give and take here. But I'm asking that we slow down. I cannot support this ordinance the way it's written. So please come tonight. Tell us how you feel. And what people talk about is the developers or the special interest. My wife and I, we've built two homes, and we've built them both with small builders, people who have 6 to 8 people in 6, 8, 10 homes a year. And they use a lot of subs. They use a lot of local electricians, local plumbers, local framing people. Point is all those people are going to be impacted. It's not just the big developers. Lord knows, by the time this is all done, the little guy, the small business owner, the small business guy will be hurt dramatically. The big guys, they got enough money. They can make it through. But we need to be careful. We need to take this slowly, and we need to make sure we know what we're doing with accurate information. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Hewitt. Last week, I went to the hospital for a doctor's breakfast, thanking all the doctors in our county for all their services. I'm grateful myself. I think I told them, I said, I've had numerous things in the past 5 or 6 years that have happened to me, and also I'm grateful to say that on Friday afternoon about 2 o'clock, Dr. Fritz at the local OR here removed my injection port that I've had buried in my chest for about 1.5 years now. She took that out, and two good things is I'm feeling better about it already, you know, sort of healing up, and I don't feel that big knot in my chest anymore. And she told me she was having a little problem getting it out, and I said, because I was awake, I mean, I was numbed, and I had a pretty nurse on this side was holding my hand. I was supposed to squeeze it hard if I felt pain. And so I said, okay, but don't tell my wife this, of course. And I'm holding some pretty nurse's hand. And then she was working on it. She was tugging. I said, is something wrong? She goes, yes. She says, you have thick skin. I said, really, that's why I'm the commissioner president. I have to understand. But I'm grateful for all these doctors with you, I really do. And this part of my life is out, and the doctors all say I'm fine. I hope this doesn't occur again. I don't want to go through the chemo and radiation again. But for those of you out there, I would say this port definitely is something you want to consider if you do have to have cancer and you do have to have treatment done. At this point, I'm going to talk a little bit about this development impact fee and its excise tax. I have inserts out of the overview of Maryland's local government, finance, demographic information, Department of Legislative Services 2017. First thing I want to read is development impact fee, excise tax. All the counties in our state either have an impact fee or an excise tax that goes against building new construction. Development impact fees and building excise taxes enable local government to collect revenue from builders for public facilities necessitated by new residential or commercial development. As a result of these development charges, local governments are able to shift the cost of financing new public facilities from existing taxpayers to individuals responsible for the development. In many situations, the use of such development charges may eliminate the need for jurisdiction-wide tax increases. In other words, we don't have to raise your income tax or your property tax for new development. St. Mary's County, as you read in the paper just recently, was the fourth fastest growing county in Maryland since 2010. According to the U.S. Census Bureau, in 2000, we had 86,233 residents, and the impact fee was $4,500. In 2016, we have 112,587, and I understand it's now going over 113,000 people, and the impact fee is still $4,500. We have a 30% growth in our population and 0% increase in our impact fee. Just this year, school enrollment increased by 192 students. Impact fees pay for the capital improvements for schools, roads, and parks as our county grows. The impact fee was set in 2000 and has not been changed in 17 years. It's not enough to accommodate our growth needs. So since not enough money was collected to impact fees, we have been using your tax dollars to pay for the growth. In other words, we go bonding market, borrow money even to improve roads. We are also looking at an increase in the impact fee. Actually, nothing's been decided yet. The current methodology uses the CIP budget. The proposed calculations use the audited capitalized assess and the growth rate as calculated by the Maryland Department of Planning. It is not a perfect formula, but it gets us closer to where we need to be. In addition, the new ordinance will allow for us to pay for not only schools, parks, and roads, but can also be used for other things such as baby water, sewer, baby solid waste, or similar facilities in our county. We don't want to raise taxes to pay for the growth. We ought to be able to use the impact fees. We invite you to tonight's public hearing at 6:30 p.m. right here. We want to hear from you on this very important issue. Oh, by the way, I talked to the Commissioner President of Charles County just yesterday at lunch with him. They increased not only their impact fee, they actually used a tax. They also initiated a transfer fee of 0.5%. And I asked Commissioner Murphy, how did the briefing go on that last year? Of course, everybody in real estate industry and all said it was going to stop growth in Charles County. Things would decrease. But I said, well, how did it impact you? They had a 22% increase in home sales in Charles County. Please come tonight, 6:30.